to you on this day. God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Dr. Rolf Jacobson of Luther Seminary said this week, because it's painful, we don't want to talk about it. I think that's a pretty worthwhile quote, because I think it's true. Things are painful, we don't want to talk about them. And divorce is one of those things we don't want to talk about. I think this is one of those passages that pastors don't want to preach on because it is painful. We don't want to reopen old scars or peel scabs off wounds that are just starting to heal. I think a lot of my colleagues would much rather talk about Genesis and the naming of the animals. That's a lot more fun. Or maybe Jesus in Hebrews and what that means for us. I think those are good decisions to make sometimes, truthfully. Divorce is one of those things that is painful, and it is real, and it is real suffering and pain. It can be real hell for people. It can almost feel like a death. What better place to talk about death and a new life that is possible in Christ than here? I read this study this week. I thought it was kind of interesting. You've probably known the statistic for as long as I have, and how people say that 50% of marriages end in divorce. Well, this was about that, and it was actually trying to say that that's not actually true. That the way that that is usually put together is they look at how many marriages happen in a year, about 2 million in our country, and then they divide that by the divorce rate. So if there's 2 million new marriages and there's 1 million divorces, 2 against 1 is half. That's how that's put together. Just like if you've watched any of the presidential debates or campaigns, it's not that the numbers are wrong, it's just how you read them that seems to differ so greatly. And whether you think one way's guy of doing an equation is better than the others, it's probably where you sit. But that is the way that that is computed. I don't think it quite adds up because, if there's 2 million new marriages and 1 million dissolve, that million are still around the next year when you do the same analysis. You're going to have 2 million and 3 million and 4 million and 5 million. It's not quite an easy calculation like that. Although it really scares you and puts you in your place, I think, which is what it's designed for. I looked at this other study by the U.S. Census. I think this is maybe a little more helpful. They looked at 1,000 married women age 16 and up. Don't ask me why they chose women and not men. This is just important. But they looked at that and they said, the divorce rate's gone up and it's come down, actually. So in 1960, over 50 years ago, per 1,000 women married, about 9 were divorced. And that rose through the 60s and 70s, as you can probably imagine, for any number of reasons, reaching its zenith in 1980 at about 22.6 per thousand. Actually, in the last several years, it's come down and actually has plateaued. Since about 2005, it's hovered around 16 per thousand. I don't know what those statistics mean, because if you're going through divorce, have been through divorce, or know somebody that's been divorced, none of those statistics matter. Which is why it is important to talk about it, because it is. I'm not one that's been through divorce, so I don't know what that's like. I can only imagine it to be as painful as I've witnessed. To really be a place of true suffering, the way you kind of call yourself into question and doubt. Your identity is kind of lost for a time. I've watched people go through that. I've had family members go through divorce. The little ones, nieces and nephews, who didn't understand what was happening at the time. Through a church that they were a part of that judged partially through that. Didn't take the time to listen or to try to understand all the complexities that human relationships are, every single one of them, and think about what that might mean in the midst of that, and how to care for a family in the midst of that kind of turmoil. So people were judged partially. So it's kind of cruel when you're at your lowest point, feeling getting kicked while you're down by the people that you rely on the most. It doesn't seem to sit right with me. I've watched other people go through it too. When I was a kid, I had a friend, his name was Aaron. was a good friend of mine. We went through church school together. I was over at his house a lot. He was over at my house a lot. I like to sleep over at his house because they had this sectional couch that was kind of a semicircle, and you could pull it apart, and it was great for like G.I. Joe bases. It was really cool. I loved that. It was really fun. But his parents, I loved his parents, and we would sit at the dinner table in a way that we didn't at home. We would pray at the dinner table like we did at home, the only other friend I knew liked that. And then his parents would ask us questions, not just about our day, but kind of faith questions, what we thought about it. And Aaron, my friend, and his sister, and I, we had to answer them before we left the table. I kind of liked it. It was cool. Then they got divorced. It was one of those, it was really, really shocking to me, as I'm sure it was to Aaron and his sister. I'm not sure what the church did in the midst of that, but you know how things kind of get negotiated. Neither of them got the church in the end. I kind of stopped seeing my friend after that. We lived on opposite sides of town. We went to a different high school, lost track of him. Actually, a couple years ago, we reunited on Facebook. He's actually a Presbyterian pastor in Dallas. That was pretty neat. Watching people struggle through this, I mean, I'm not a marriage counselor, I don't train for that. The depth and complexity of all the issues are there, but I feel like, I mean, the church should be a place where we do talk about pain, where we do talk about the realities of life, where we do talk about how awful this stuff is on the ground, because it's where we live. And it's easy just to judge, or it's easy just to quote Bible verses sometimes, but it seems to do people a disservice, too, in some ways. And in a way, I think we know better than that, because as much as it would have been easier to talk about the naming of the animals, and I think that's an awesome story, it really is fun. Or to talk about Jesus being the word that speaks to us here and now, I like that, too. Or even the psalm, how great creation is. Love it. Absolutely. I think it is worth talking about this because it's painful. Because if we know anything about the God who gathers us together, we know this consistent message that no matter how big things seem, or how awful problems linger in our lives, how much guilt we have, what we've done and left undone, how we've treated people, how we feel like we've been treated, how awful that seems and feels in every reality that is in our lives, we know that the love and mercy and forgiveness that Christ offers is bigger than that. I mean, that's what the cross is all about. It's to bring our pain and suffering, those places that feel like real death in our lives, and to dump them where they belong, at the cross. Because it's there where new life comes. Undeserved. And that's who we are. I should probably just stop talking. Because I think that's a good enough message. But I do want to look at this passage in particular, because I do find it also kind of interesting, the interplay that happens. Mark starts off by telling us that the Pharisees come to Jesus to test him. I mean, they're not just asking for casual advice. I'm not just asking what's a better divorce policy than we have now. Please, Jesus, fill us in. They're asking him because they're testing him. It's the same thing like when they ask him about taxes. I mean, it's a loaded question. It's meant to trick him. They want to get in his words because they've already made up their mind about Jesus. They want him out of it. They want to kill him. And so they ask him a question that they can later condemn him on. So just for taxes, when they ask him, is it lawful or not? He says, well, pull a coin out of your pocket and tell me whose head's on the face of the coin. And they say, well, Caesar's is. And so he says, well, give back to Caesar what is Caesar's and give to God what is God. And he beats them at the wrong game. And this situation is kind of the same in a way. They ask him, is it lawful to divorce your wife or not? And rather than just saying yes or no and going home, he asks them a question. Well, what did Moses say? And they say, well, you know, you can write a certificate and tell your wife that she's gone. And then you send a memo, an email, leave a pink slip in the inbox or something. I mean, think of that. It's ridiculous. be for a woman in an ancient culture, where they have no economic ability to make a life on their own, no voice, no property rights, in fact, they're even viewed as property in a lot of places. What this means, I mean, if you let the stew on the pot too long and it burned, I mean, you could be out, let alone any other reason, with nothing. No way to provide for yourself, basically a death sentence, more or less. I mean, even the institution of marriage in those days was really around protection. You know, if you have some daughters, how do you protect them? You marry them off to someone else who can provide for them, hopefully in your own same economic status. And you hope that she doesn't die in childbirth, or you hope that she at least has some sons to provide for her when her husband will die, probably before her. And that was kind of life on the ground. I mean, not easy. And we like to wrap our lives around romance and love and how that feels and think about that. But we live in a different place where people have more opportunity than they've ever had. Men and women in life. Different situation. But Jesus, he kind of answers it, but he kind of doesn't. He kind of dismisses this, actually. It's like, you know, Deuteronomy, this is what Moses says. But really what I want to tell you about is creation. I want to tell you that every human being is made in the image and likeness of God. And because of your hardness of heart, the way you live such broken, sinful lives, that's why you divorce each other in the first place. It's not what God intends for us. As long as it is to talk about the animals, it's also that story about humanity, about community, about families, about how it is we live our lives as people that are created in the image and the likeness of God. How amazing that is. How good that can be. And so when that falls apart, it's no wonder it feels so awful. It's no wonder it's so broken. It's no wonder we don't want to talk about it. Because it does kind of seem like a death in a way. That's what Jesus is talking about. That it's about God making us, putting us into community with each other as families and with one another in a wider sense. May all of us contribute to the brokenness that we see around us. And the last part of this is, I think, the best part. Because it continues. And Jesus invites the children to come. Which is great, we've got a lot of kids here today. You know, kids have this inane sense, I think. They can tell, you know, which adults can serve, or which adults don't like them very much, or adults, you know, want to break stuff if they're sticky hands on things, you know. But I think kids also get, almost innately, when they are welcome, and when people like them, enjoy having them around, love them. I mean, every week I have the opportunity to see the kids as they come forward. Some of them, when they come around, I mean, it's when they make eye contact with me, their face lights up. So it's great. I mean, that's what Jesus is talking about. I mean, we make things as adults so overly complicated. Really, what Jesus is saying is just keep it simple. I mean, keep it as simple as it is when you're a kid. When you see that person that loves you, and you can't wait to leap into their arms, because that is what Jesus is saying he is for us. All of us, even us complicated adults. So he invites us to come like that. And when we hear about the broken and sinfulness of this world and we know how much we contribute to it and we see it all around us, it's important for us to remember how wide Jesus' arms stretch on that cross for us all. When you see a child come, it's even better. As you see those same arms wrap around them with love and care and that sweet embrace. And that's what Jesus invites us to. And I want you to think about, as you leave this place today, after we're done in worship, after if you've had enough coffee and snacks, and have caught up with each other. You go home this day is to remind your loved ones how much they mean to you. To hold them in that same love and care that Christ keeps us all in. Let them know that, broken and sinful as we are. the same time, I also invite you to be on the lookout. Be on the lookout for those who are in the depths of despair. Those whose suffering seems paramount. Who feel like they are in the midst of death all around them. Because it's to them that you and I are sent to bring that embrace. Because it's painful, we can talk about it. That's what Christian life is all about. Bring our pain and suffering and sinfulness and brokenness and leave it at the cross where it belongs. Because that, where we are broken, that is the new life we are given. And just remind ourselves wherever we go that all of us are welcome in this place.